This is the last of a series that we started right shortly after Christmas time. I think it's about 12 weeks. I think that's the longest kind of topical thing we've done here. It was kind of a long one, but we were looking at the Old Testament and going through this story of the Old Testament and highlighting some of the key familiar stories that many of us know. But we were doing it in hopefully a little bit different light as we were looking to bring some illumination to God's big plan that He has for people. It started with the question, you know, what do we need that Christmas for? What did that Christmas child need to come for? And so we went back to look at some of these key stories that were there to get this overarching narrative of what God is doing throughout all time about doing this business of what it is that He's doing to draw all people back to Him, to redeem people, you and me included, back into Himself and back into a good relationship and back into His good and holy, His holy presence. His desire throughout all of this, you know, we found that this thing that He just keeps to be saying throughout all of this text is what God wants to do is, I want to dwell with you, He seems to be saying over and over again. I want to be with you. I want to be your God, and I want for you to be my people. It is his story. It is His story, but He's carved out this part of the story for you and I to participate in. And that's what is so incredible about this story as we look at it. And I hope as we've kind of, you know, took this quick jet stream view over all of this history that you've gotten a little deeper appreciation of this story and our place in the story a little bit more for yourself. You know, I went back, I'll admit to you, I don't remember what I preached last week. My memory is just short. I gotta, you know, you'd think if somebody would remember the sermon, it would be the guy that gave it, but it don't, you know. I gotta go back and say, what did I say last week? And I did more than that. I kind of went back and reviewed this whole series just to kind of see, you know, how did the message go? You know, how did God lead us as we went through all this? And I wanted to get kind of an overview about what it was that we talked about. And one of the things that popped out at me is I was just, you know, for me, again, it's an awesome experience to go through here and do this. And I hope for some of you it was as well. But one of the things that kind of pops out at me that really wasn't related to what we're talking directly about was there's this rising attitude that's coming from within the church to just to take this Old Testament that's here and do away with it. Let's see. The language by a very popular pastor says we need to unhitch the Old Testament from our faith. It's just not relevant anymore to us, and we need to quit spending time there. We need to be thinking about we're New Testament people, and just disregard the Old Testament. And you know, that's one thing that's kind of stood out to me. I'll be the first to admit, you know, we don't preach on the Old Testament a lot. We don't do a lot of studies on the Old Testament. It's maybe a little more difficult. It is a little, the culture that's there and the way God's working with the people is different than He works with you and I in 2021. So, you know, naturally there are some things that are there that are maybe a little more difficult for us to do. But to disregard this as part of our sacred text is bemoaning to me. Is that a word, bemoaning? I don't know if I use that word right, but you know, I guess if people want to take the large part of this text out and throw it away, I'd be like moaning. So bemoaning. Am I using the word right? Mike says no. I'll look it up. I'll Google that and find out if bemoaning is right. But no, seriously, as I think about this large segment of our church that wants to just do away with this part of the text that we've spent these 12 weeks on, it is disappointing. It's saddening to me that this is, as I went and looked back on this, and I looked at the text from, you know, kind of fresh perspective and with a different overarching question, you know, I found what it does is it just showed me God. And I believe that is one of the big purposes of what the text is for. It reveals His character to us. In the Old Testament, we find out who He is. We find out about His love. We find out about His insistence on perfection and holiness. The characters revealed in those Old Testament stories. We find about His hatred of sin and of unrighteousness. That is revealed in these stories throughout these main stories that we hit for the last 12 weeks. And we found this constant pursuit of putting this stuff away once and for all. This sin and unrighteousness and unholiness. All of these things that he hates. We find that throughout this story, it's his pursuit to stamp it out and be done with it once and for all. That's what these texts do. They show us who God is throughout the way that he deals with the people in these stories that we've been talking about. And throughout this, as I went back and kind of looked at how we summarized each week's message, so many times the story points to the coming of Christ. It's just so interesting that we see that, you know, what was happening thousands of years before Christ came were these foreshadowings, these things that took place that made sense when Christ came. And they only could make sense because he came. And he brings all of this to a head. And I think the story also teaches us about ourselves. I think that's part of what this is doing. As we go back and we see how God relates with people and how people responded, you know, we're people too. And we can relate with how people responded to God in those stories. So about him, as we look back and we kind of, you know, go through that mess of all those characters that I borrowed from Superbook. I think if anybody recognizes the cartoon there that we've been using here, those characters that were used there to represent these key people in these key times there. You know, God is all powerful and all knowing, and he does this creative thing. And then the culmination of creation is you and me. Humanity is the end of this creative act, and he makes us in this special way to be in relationship with him. And that starts this story about us as we relate how we fit into that we were created in this special, awesome way. And in that creative process, you know, he gave us all these freedoms, all this freedom to do, to be, to share in all of creation. We had tremendous freedom, but that's not to say that there weren't boundaries. There were boundaries that he asked humankind to live by. You know, you can picture that right in Eden. All the food and all the stuff and all the glory and all the beauty that was there in the presence. But, remember? But, there's a tree. You know, there was a boundary. And so he gives us these boundaries. And that happens throughout the rest of these stories. Boundaries are given in different ways. And we find out what happens when people violate those boundaries, because that is a constant theme throughout all of these stories as well. What happens when people mess up? You know, he just doesn't disregard us. This constant story is this endless pursuit of him hearkening us back to him, finding new and different ways for us to come back into a relationship with him. How does he do it? Well, he put a garden out there, first of all, for us to relate with, and that didn't work. So I got to bring these people back. So he chooses a people. He chooses Abraham and all the family of the Hebrews, the Jewish people, for the purpose of bringing people back. That was his mechanism. And he puts covenants in place. I want to relate with you, and so here's this deal that we've got. Here's this covenant that's here. And another way that he chose to stay related with people were through his spokespeople or his prophets. We talked about that the last couple weeks ago. When people would get out of line, he'd raise up a prophet or a judge. It was a spokesperson that would come and say, hey, here's the word of the Lord. This is where people, you're off the mark, and here's where I want you to be. Those are all mechanisms by which he's going to choose to do this, to bring us back into relationship with him. But then it comes to a head, the thing that he does ultimately to come and dwell and be with us and to hearken all of us back to him is when he came. Ultimately, when he came himself, Christ, on that Christmas morning. We learn that he's faithful. Boy, if there's something you pull out of the stories that we talked about, you know, we can have confidence in him today because of the record that we have of him here. We have confidence in him because what he said he would do, he did. So therefore, what he says he will do, he will do. It is his story, but he's carved out this place for you and I to be in it. And about us, you know, clearly for me, as we look at these stories, we can see how this just projects. The Old Testament just, it projects to Christ. It projects to the church. It projects to the coming of the Spirit in this age that you and I live in, where we are in right relationship with God because of what's happened on a cross. Everything kind of seems to be pointing that way. It projects thousands of years ago into what happened when Christ came, and it projects 2,000 years later into our time as well. But I think cool too about this, and I think what those people don't get that want to throw the Old Testament away, is it also takes us in this era and projects us back then. We participate in this story because we're pushed backwards into that. We see our story today as it was lived out in the people's lives thousands of years ago. The story for them then is our story today. It reveals things about me, and I'm guessing that it reveals things about you too. As I'm projected back there, I find out why we were created. Why was I made? What's the purpose that I came into this existence? And yet I have this great opportunity to connect with that Creator. That's the story that I'm drawing out of this, out of the Old Testament. I also learned that I'm similar to a lot of the people there that had this same encounter with Him. They had this yearning to rebel and to reject and to resist. That seems to be kind of common with, and I'll speak for myself, for me and perhaps you as well. We were born and created to bear His image. And we understand that because this dwelling that we know that He has, we get it now because He's in us. We were promised that when we trusted in Christ that His Spirit would come and take up residency in us. So this passion of God to dwell among you is fulfilled in you and I today because we're this temple and we possess Him in His Spirit. We bear that image. But again, because we're people, we just want to mess up with that image sometimes. We want to smear the image sometimes. We want to mar that image. We want to deface the image. And we need to repent of that and turn. We have this important place, I believe, in this story. This story that we're finding that we are really a part of, it's really supposed to be the center of my story. The story of Joel. That was a boring one. But my story's center is to be how I relate to God's story and you as well. We are supposed to find our very center of all that we do should be a reflection of the relationship that we have with Him. Everything that we do should be about bearing that image that we profess, we say we bear. Every element of our lives should be doing that. But like those people that messed up, I do too. You know, like David, who fell because, and so many people fell because their eyes got to be after that which looked appealing. That's, you know, such a problem for so many people in so many different ways. What appeals to me that's different than him? And we start chasing those things, and we start putting things in front of him that we shouldn't put in front of him. That's the Old Testament thing too. How many times did we read where they went and they served other gods and they worshiped other things and they built things of worship that they put in front of God? Man, I learned that about myself too. I find ways and can invent ways that I'll put things that are in front of him. They're idols. I learn about myself in those ways. And sometimes I find that I desire to be like the other nations. Remember, we read that last a couple weeks ago where Israel's supposed to be this people that's set apart and drawn apart to do his work. But remember what drew them? They wouldn't be like the other guys. They want to be like the other nations. You know, and I struggle with that too. I want to be like the cool kids. You know, there's that desire to be, you know, like society and be what's trending and be what fits, what's politically correct in our society. That's a pull for us. No different than the struggles that people had then when they were supposed to be this people who were set apart holy. That's what holy means, set apart for his good work. What a great story, what an awesome story that we're told. This story that you and I continue to tell. And really what we're finding is the deeper we get into this is it's not just a story out there, it's a story we're in. We're not spectators, we're participants in this story. So where we're closing this out, where we're currently at with this story, if you remember what had happened, you know, Israel wanted to be like all the other cool nations, and they wanted a king. And God said, don't do that, but they still wanted it. And so they set up this monarchy, and they had a system of king, led a division within the nation. They split, formed two nations, had kings over here and kings over here, and it didn't work. And because they chased things that were not in line with what God had them do, consequences happened. Last week we talked about this, where it didn't take Israel that long, just a couple hundred years from when they started their monarchy in 722, they're annihilated by Assyria, gone, out of their land. It took about another 150 years later, same thing happened in the southern country called Judah, and it was Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians that came in 586 BC. Same thing, annihilated them, ruined the temple, took all their stuff, put all these people into exile. And so now we are at this point where all of Israel, what about Abraham? Remember the promise of Abraham. He said, God told Abraham hundreds of years ago, get up and go, and I'm going to give you this land. You're going to be a great nation. You're not going to be able to count you. You're going to be so big. You're going to have this land. It's flowing with milk and honey. You're going to be my people. I'm going to be your God. And that happened. They're in Israel. All this stuff's happening. And they're God's chosen people. And now we're at the point where they got booted. What would they have been thinking? They're scattered all over the area here. A lot of them now are in Babylon because that's where Nebuchadnezzar has carried them to. They're lost. They would have a feeling of hopelessness. It's where they are. They have no identity. Their national identity is gone. Their connection with God is gone because their temple is gone. They can't do anything. So you understand that there would have been this horrible feeling of who they would have identified themselves on. What is it we are to do? We're not in that land. But throughout that story, as bad as it gets, and this is one of those bad as it gets kind of moments where we find ourselves in 585 BC-ish in there, is there is hope. There's a glimmer of hope. God continues his plan. He has this plan that he started from the beginning to dwell with his people and to be people's God and for people to acknowledge him as God. A remnant people left over to continue this plan that he started with Abraham. He chose them, and he's going to continue this. It isn't all over. Where there is darkness, his light will shine. What seems impossible, he'll find a way. And where there is death, there's a promise of life. And this is where they're at. All these people stuck away from their land. And this is where they're at. And God raises up the prophet Ezekiel. And Ezekiel's going to get a vision and a message from God for people who have no hope. And it is a cool story. It is such a neat story about how God reveals his plan. This comes from Ezekiel chapter 37, starting in verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me, Ezekiel, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many of bones on the floor of the valley. Bones that were very dried. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? Now that's a kind of one of those rhetorical questions I would probably say as he had him moving along that valley of those bones. You know, it's a pretty straightforward answer that Ezekiel would have had for God. Dusty old bones in the middle of a desert. And he's let him see all that stuff as the picture depicts there. Ezekiel, can these bones live? Well, if we jump down ahead what this means, just to get ahead of the story just a little bit in verse 11, again of chapter 37, God says to Ezekiel, he says, Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Israel, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. You see the picture that he painted. He's representing this hopelessness that all of Israel would have been feeling because they got booted out of their land. And that's what God's saying. These bones, these dried up old nothing people here, that's Israel. And this is how they are viewing themselves. We're dried up and our hope is gone. We're cut off. We no longer have relationships. So Ezekiel, can these bones live? So Ezekiel says this, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I'll attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, so you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. And so Ezekiel says, so I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, man, I can't wait to see this replayed when I'm in heaven, because this is going to be cool. As I prophesied when I was there, there was a noise, a rattling sound. And the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and tendons and flesh appeared on them and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain that they may live. Then you'll know, he goes on to say, who I am. That what you see here now is not hopeless, but I'm going to bring you back. This story that I started a long time ago, it's not done. There's more to this story. It looks bad right now, but just as those dead bones can have life, I say, live. What an awesome message for the people then who would have lost their land and their country and their connection with God. They would have said, we were dead, and now he's going to give life. You see the hope that Ezekiel would have given those people then. What an awesome message that this works out to me this day as we look at this scene, because I think it foreshadows another graveyard and another victory. Today's Palm Sunday. It's the beginning of Holy Week. We sang about it a couple times. They sang King, King of Kings and Hosanna, and they waved those branches. Here comes Jesus, our Messiah, that Sunday of Holy Week. Those shouts of Hosanna, we know, would quickly change from Hosanna to the word crucify. Crucify him. And they did. And we did. We crucified him. There was death. Death that took place in a place of bones, not that unlike what Ezekiel saw. But there was hope. And there was another breath. Life would come again. When Jesus conquered death, Matthew, the only gospel writer that said when he conquered death, graves were opened up. And those people that had been in the grave came back to life. And they walked around and they talked with the people that were in Jerusalem at that time. Like the vision that Ezekiel had. In all hopelessness, there was life. It came again. Christ conquered death. Bone to bone and tendon to tendon and skin and breath. Why? So that they may live. So that you and I, through a cross, may live. Do we see that hope? Prophesy to the breath, he said, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these that they may live. That you and I may live. This is our great story. It's our great story because we are as good as that pile of bones in a desert. We're doomed because of who we are and what we have. But Jesus had different plans. He came to town that Palm Sunday to breathe. He came then to bring these dead bones of all humanity back to life by dying on a cross, paying the price for my sin. Satisfying the penalty of all sins, yours and mine. Dying that he may live. What great hope. Do you see the hope in this story? I see other bones too as I think about that picture. I see the bones of a church that's gotten sleepy and kind of dead about what it is that they're called to do, about being church. A church that's gotten too caught up in the problems of the day, keeping it from being the kingdom kind of people that the church is supposed to be doing, keeping it from being a nation of priests, about doing his will. It's like this pile of dead bones that needs life. So think about that pile of bones. Think about those people Ezekiel wrote to that needed breath to live. Think about your life that needed blood to live. And think now about this church who needs His Spirit to live. Hear those words one more time.
So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound. And the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them. And skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come breath from the four winds and breathe into these slain that they may live.
Live. Drop onto the word of the Lord. Live. Live. Drop onto the word of the Lord. Live. Live. Drop onto the word of the Lord.
Father, we're hearing them dry bones. We're hearing those dry bones rattle here. We know it's you. We praise you this week for what it is we're reminded you did for us then. We hear you rattling now in this church as you have place to do great things. We praise you for that already because we know good things are in store for Pleasant Chapel. Lord, I'd ask a blessing on this food as we take some time to fellowship together. Ask your Spirit to be upon this group. As it goes from here, we ask that your Spirit would come heavily on us as we come back here to meet again and to hear your will for this church. Praise your name. Amen. Amen. You may eat.